How you doing? Are you glad the snow is gone? Yeah, we got us a little and that was a blessing, but I was glad when it was gone. And then I flew to Buffalo, New York. Guess what they had? Snow everywhere. Praise God. I got back to Charlotte yesterday and it was wonderful. Sunny and 50 degrees, and I praise the Lord for it. We're glad you're in church this morning. We want to go ahead and pray and ask the Lord to help us. But right before we do that, Peyton, you got your fellas ready? We've been doing a challenge. Go ahead and get them in place somewhere. We've been doing a challenge this year on passing out tracts, and you can text Brother Marvin, and you can put it on the church Facebook page or direct message him on Twitter for the church Twitter, all them different ways. But if you don't do any of that, you just want to write it down. We need you to write down how many tracts you've given out now the last two weeks, because we didn't do it last Sunday for the snow day. So if you want one of those cards, you can just, don't put your name on it, just put how many tracts you've given out in the last couple of weeks. If you're going to estimate low. We don't want to evangelistically count and cheat. We want to be honest. But go ahead and raise your hand if you need one of those cards. We'll put them in the offering plate here in just a minute. Play softly if you would, Miss Scott. Let's pray. We'll ask the Lord to meet with us this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Thank you for the many blessings. Lord, I'm thankful for the praise reports that we have to give today, things that you've done for folks this week. Lord, I praise you for safe traveling there and back, and I thank you there was no serious delays. Had one little delay. I thank you for that, Lord, not letting the weather be a problem getting home. And I praise you for safety there. Thank you, Lord, for blessing spiritually here last week, even though many couldn't come. Lord, it was good services, and we praise you for that. We thank you, Lord, for blessing this week. And Ryder getting saved. We thank you, Lord, for folks getting good reports in the last couple of weeks. Brother Boyce got a good report. Miss Parker got a good report. We thank you for that. Thank you for helping Brother Hilliard's surgery go well the other day. We ask you now, Lord, oh, that you'd meet with us today. We need something fresh and new from you in this service. We ask you, Lord, that you'd help our hearts and minds to be clean of anything that might hinder the Holy Ghost. Remove any bitterness or jealousy or anger or wrath or malice or envy. Anything, Lord, that might be a critical spirit or a hateful spirit or a judgmental spirit, we pray that you'd remove all that. We pray, Father, that you'd help the Holy Spirit to be able to move freely in and out of these pews and speak to us as we need it today. I believe you've got something for us in the singing and in the preaching today, and I pray that you'd help us to be ready to receive it. And we love you. If there be anybody here unsaved, we'd like to see them get saved today, Lord. It's the best thing that ever happened to any of us. It was the day that we got born again. And I praise you for that. And help us to worship you as you're worthy of, and we want you to be pleased and blessed and your people to be helped. And we'll praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, stand and grab a hymn book. What number, Brother Kenneth? Number 19. If you'd grab a hymn book, turn to number 19. Number 19. If you were not here on the snow services, you really missed something special last Sunday night. Last Sunday night, the Lord moved in and slapped me off the steps over here, and I rolled. How many of you have seen on social media a video of such a thing? All right, real life was good, but it has now gotten probably about 20,000 looks on social media. So far, I've not made any money from it, but I'm looking for that. Amen. I've been such a blessing to this nation this week. I am now dubbed the Holy Roller. And tonight, where I was in Buffalo, they made us a little remix video. They made a little video where I fall down, and then it goes whoop, 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 and I fall four times. And it's got sound effects with it. We'll watch that tonight if you'll come be in church tonight at 6 o'clock. What number?
19.
Now, if you're visiting with us, we appreciate you being here today. We want to give you a visitor packet. If you never visited before or you didn't get one of these packets, lift your hand up now. Let these guys give that to you, and we'll sing on number 19. We need one over here in the back, brother. Keep coming, Brother Eric.
When I see the blood, Christ the Redeemer died on the cross, died for the sinner, paid all his dues. Sprinkle your soul with the blood of the Lamb, and I will pass over you. When I see the blood, when I see the blood, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Chiefest of sinners, Jesus the same, all he hath promised that he will do. Wash in the fountain, open for sin, and I will pass over you. I see the blood, when I see the blood, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Judgment is coming, all will be there, each one receiving justly his due. I am the saving, sin cleansing blood, and I will pass over you. When I see the blood, when I see the blood, when I see the blood, I will pass over you.
stand while the choir's coming down. Shake hands with somebody around you there this morning. Smile at them. Say something nice to them. That'll be a blessing. Be seated. It's a little bit cool in here this morning, isn't it? Yeah, we're working on it. Now, Brother Roy wanted me to let you know that he was not the one. No, it wasn't me. It wasn't me either. I came in this morning at 9 and everything was on heat and it was all good, and I knew all you people would come in here and breathe and it would warm right up. I came in a while ago and felt like it's an air conditioner right over here, because it was. Somebody had turned the air on that one. So don't you touch it, whoever you are. One of them, somebody in here having hot flashes and freezing the rest of us to death. Praise God. All right, listen, Brother Ken's got some announcements this morning. Hopefully it'll warm up in just a minute.
All right, ladies, do remember this afternoon there's going to be a baby shower for Miss Ashley Mace. That will be out at the school cafeteria at 5 o'clock. And Brother Jason wanted me to announce that on February the 23rd to the 25th, we will be doing the public school revival. And, of course, we'll be talking about that more as it gets closer. And then also they're going to be having an outing. The teenagers are going to have a tubing trip to Hawk's Nest, and that will be March the 3rd through the 5th. So, parents, keep that in mind. A couple of prayer requests. Be praying for Brother Sam Phillips's dad, his mom. She is in the hospital, been in the hospital all week, and they had just taken her to Asheville this morning. So be praying for her if you would. And then also be praying for Tommy Barrier's dad, as he is taking cancer treatments and he's got a bad infection, and they're trying to find out what is going on there. So be praying for him if you would. And also Brother Wayne Randolph is sick. So pray that the Lord would heal these folks and watch over them. And then, good news, we have got a brand new baby here this morning. I believe Brother BJ and Miss Stephanie have their baby, Everly. Is that right? Somewhere? There it is. There she is. Good job. Praise the Lord for that. BJ didn't drop her. It's a blessing. All right, we've got a diaper bag up here. And after the service, let's come up and be a blessing to them. Put something in there. And when you come in this morning, you should have got a little faith promise card. Of course, we had our missions conference about 2 weeks ago, and then last week we didn't do the faith promise because of the snow and not very many people being here. But hopefully you've been thinking about that and talking to the Lord about what he'd have you do for faith promise this year. And of course, don't put your name on that, but just so that we can have an idea of how much we can plan on as far as doing for missions this year, fill that out if you would. And then after the service, we will collect those, and then we will do this again tonight, for I know there's other people in Sunday school and things like that. So if you want to turn it in tonight, we can do that also. But let's try and do something big for missions this year. All right, let's go ahead and have the ushers come forward, and we will take up our morning offering.
Just in case some of you might not know what Faith Promise Missions is, and it's simply what the words say. It's by faith, you tell the Lord what you think you would be willing to give to missions monthly, and that's above your tithes and above your regular offerings, what you normally give for tithes and offerings. By the way, I don't know that I've ever said this, but you know, if you didn't get to come last week, then the Lord still expects your tithes. So just pray about that and think about that a little bit, praise God, head jerk message number one. And but faith promise is above your tithes. You say, well, we don't have any more. Well, that's why it's called faith, because the Bible teaches that God will give. If you'll promise to give it, he'll give it to you. And so you just maybe do, if you've never done any, you might say, well, we're going to give $25 a month or $5 a month or whatever to missions this year. And then you faithfully give that, and the Lord, I believe, will give it back to you. And we're trying to challenge everybody that's done it in the past to increase that a little bit, and that we might do more than we've ever done before. All those pictures you see on the walls, they are supported by the faith promise of the church folks. And so if you could help that, I was with a preacher this week, and he pastors a church just outside of Houston, Texas, and they got about 50 or 60 people that come, and he had 39 cards. Now listen to this, 39 cards turned in for his faith promise. Some of them were children, and those 39 cards have pledged to give this year almost $250,000 to missions, a church of about 50 people. And so it can be done by faith. Last year, they gave over $200,000, that little church of 50 people, on top of their tithes, on top of their offerings, on top of paying the light bill and everything else. It's a faith thing. So if you've never done it, you ought to pray about it, ask the Lord. You just write by faith what you think the Lord would help you to give each week or each month, ever how you want to do that, to missions, okay? Now, if you're visiting with us, we don't talk about money very much. We just happened to have just had the mission conference, needed to talk about that this morning. As a matter of fact, every week when we take up the offering, I say, if you're visiting with us, we don't expect you to give in the offering. And we mean that. We just appreciate you being here. But those of us that are here and a part of this church, we believe that the Bible teaches us that we have a regular duty that we are to give to the work of the Lord. Let me give you a couple other things to be praying about. Brother Brian is preaching in Black Mountain again this morning. That church there doesn't have a pastor. He's preached several times for them. So be praying for that church and for Brother Brian. Brother Jason Beavers is preaching in Virginia today, and so pray for him and Miss Danielle and their families. They're there. And then Brother Arnold has a trip this week, where he's right over there. He's hauling some stuff that'll eventually be going all the way to Africa, and he's taking it somewhere, then it'll be shipped from there. And so he's got one of those mission trips this week. We praise the Lord we were able to take up that offering. If you were not here last week, we were able to, in the missions conference, take up an offering each night to help pay for the rest of the truck that he uses for the ministry. And so thank God this week he'll be using it, hauling some stuff. It's going to help spread the gospel in Africa down the road. So we praise God for all of that. Be praying for those. One more prayer request, and we'll go to the offering. Is Brother Hilliard, I've mentioned to him, which is the pastor of New Horizon Baptist Church. I told you sometime back they found a tumor the base of his brain. He's got a wife. He's got three little children. And he had surgery, I think it was on Friday, something like that. Is that right, Pam? Thursday or Friday, something like that. And the surgery itself went well. As a matter of fact, they said the tumor was not as bad as they thought when they got in there. So we praise the Lord for that. But the big prayer request now is they're sending it off to see if it is malignant or not. So we're praying and asking the Lord that it not be cancerous. So you pray that pastor there, that hopefully they can just have that surgery and be done with it. And I told you one more, but let me give you another one more. Is that all right? Most of you know Brother Rick Davis, and Genesis sitting right over here is her dad. His wife Joy, they just found out last week that his wife Joy has cancer. And she's probably 28 or 29, something like that. Genesis, I don't even know. You ain't listening. How old is she, Genesis? Do you know? Huh? She ain't that old. Come on now. Well, she wouldn't want you to say that out loud. Now, I'm going to say 28 or 29 or something like that. And she has got cancer. In about 2 weeks, they're going to do a surgery. They think they can get it with the surgery, and that be it. So really pray for that. Rick just got called to pastor a church. He got ordained just a few weeks ago. He's been at the church for a few months. And, you know, just getting started in that. She's the pastor's wife, and now, you know, hit with the cancer. So you pray the Lord will help that. And then I also got this one, another one more. Pauletta called the EMS. It's on its way to take her to the hospital about her knee and something. I can't read you right in there. Whoever wrote that, I'm sorry. So praying for her. Might have infection, could be gout, whatever it is. Don't know that she got, but she can't get up and down. Miss Pauletta and Brother Sam have been through it. So let's pray right now and try and pray for these things. We'll pray for the offering as well. Father, we do thank you, Lord, that our prayers are not in vain. We thank you, Father, that there's a God in heaven that looks down on us and right now hears what we're saying as we pray. And I praise you for that truth. And I do ask you to be with these folks, be with Rick and Joy and their family. We pray that, Lord, you'd get involved, that when she has the surgery, that it would indeed be contained and they'd be able to just to do the surgery and that be it. Lord, I pray that she wouldn't have to have any treatments or anything further. I pray, Lord, for Brother Hilliard, that when his test comes back, it'd be non-malignant, it'd be non-cancerous, and that he also also then would be done with this trial, that particular thing that he's facing, he and his wife and their church there. We pray that you'd bless them. Be with the ones Brother Ken mentioned. I know Brother Wayne's sick and others are sick and have been. We pray that you'd be with each one. I think about Brother and Sister Paget, Lord. He fell and hurt himself. Now he's in the rehab and got dementia and different things, Lord. It creates a real struggle for them. We pray that you'd bless and comfort them and help them. Lord, help us that are sitting here that are not going through these things right now to realize how blessed we are. Help us, Lord, some of us that have been upset with something. I mean, something's had us really upset. And when we hear these things, we realize that little thing that's had us so bothered really isn't nothing compared to these families that are plunged into a great valley this week. So I pray that you'd help us to have our hearts right today and realize how good you've been to us and have the burden for these that are going through it. Be with Miss Pauletta right now. She's been taken to the doctor. They'd be able to figure out what's going on with her knee and get that straightened out for her. Her and Brother Sam are so faithful. And so, Lord, they keep such a good spirit as they go through all these battles they've been going through in the last few years. We pray you continue to bless them. And Lord, no doubt many others in here have burdens or know folks that are having burdens. We pray that you bless each one. Help the offering, multiply it for us, and Lord, bless the service now. In Jesus' name, amen. If you filled out one of those little track cards, you can put that in the offering plate. Just fold it up there and stick it in the offering plate. And Brother Lee has somebody tally that up. Well, all we need that just sometime this afternoon, that tally. If you've given a track out in another state, we'd like for you to let Brother Marvin know that as well. You can go on the church Facebook page and tell him. You can go on Twitter, church Twitter, and direct message him, or even email him at the church at Marvin Greer at New Manna Baptist. So any of those ways. Genesis 22, we're going to turn to several places. So if you want to mark Joshua chapter 5, we'll also go there. We'll go to two places in Genesis, then Joshua, then the book of John chapter 6. So Genesis 22, Joshua 5, John chapter 6. They're going to come on and get ready to sing for us. Some ladies are going to sing for us this morning. I wanted to give you some praise reports. I do appreciate you praying for my trip. And had good flights, one delay going. But I expected that a little bit with the weather there in the northeast, but had a great meeting, man. I'm telling you, great meeting. And I praise the Lord for that. And then also this week, Ryder got saved. Amen. Raise your hand, Ryder, right there. All right, and we'll have his daddy testify a little bit tonight maybe about all that. Look at him grinning. He called me in the middle of the night, and I'd gotten back from the service, and we'd been fellowshipping. I got my room, and it was kind of late, and my phone rang. It said, Nick Kelly. And I said, hello, actually, and I couldn't hardly hear it. It took me a minute to find my phone and get it all together, and when I got it on there, it was Ryder instead of Nick. And he said, preacher, and I like how he says preacher. He said, I prayed and got saved tonight. It was good stuff. So we'll let them, that's pretty good, amen. And then also, some of you have been praying for Carson. She'd been to the doctor. She's been to the doctor probably 7 or 8 times now in the last month or so. And it all kicked back up again this week. And they never really gave us any answers the first time. And, you know, you start worrying that they're going to keep checking. And then all of a sudden say, oh, we missed it. And it's this. And it's really, really bad. And so this week she had to go back. And they actually found this week what they believe was wrong. And she's been battling colitis, which is very painful and could flare up regularly. But I do praise the Lord that it's treatable and that it's not, you know, cancer or anything like that. So I thank you for praying and continue to pray for her as she battles that. But we do praise the Lord. I mean, I praise the Lord for that. I ask him for that. Everybody gets something. Look here, folks. Everybody gets something. All right. And when he's merciful and it's not something as bad as what we just heard some of these other folks are going through, you ought to be thankful even in the face of the adversity that he lets you face. And so I do praise him for that this week. I got a real blessing. As a matter of fact, right in the middle of the message, I got a text. Somebody else was preaching, and I got a text about that. And boy, at the invitation, I just on the altar praising the Lord. So I want to thank him for that. Genesis 22. Listen to this good song. Brother Joe.
There is a blood that cost a life, that paid my way. Death is price.
Hey, listen now.
When it flowed down from the cross, my sins were gone, my sins forgotten. There is a
Hallelujah for the blood of Jesus. Amen. I make a lot of mistakes. I make mistakes as dad, as husband, as pastor, preacher, person. Come on. I mean, I do. I know I do. I repent regularly, daily. Repent. Say, Lord, I'm sorry I said that. I'm sorry I did that. I'm sorry I didn't do that. But I'm thankful for the blood of Jesus that deals with those sins in my life. I bless His holy name. I'm thankful there is a fountain filled with blood. Yeah. It washes our sins away. I preached here a few Wednesday nights ago, a big 10-4 about the blood of bulls and goats can never take away sins. But there is blood that doesn't just cover them. It takes them away forever. Bless His holy name. It is good to be saved. It is good to be a child of God, to know that even in our faults and failures, and I hate failing people. I don't like letting folks down, hurting folks, doing different things. I don't like that. But I am thankful, but it's between you and the Lord, that you can get forgiveness. Amen for that. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Bless His holy name goes right there. Amen. You ought to be glad for the blood of Jesus. Yeah, boy. Precious blood. Powerful blood. There's no sin so bad He can't forgive it. No sinner so bad the blood of Jesus can't save them. Amen. Hey, listen, it's forever and forever. Every little child that realizes they're a sinner and wants to be saved, there's still enough blood they can be saved. Amen. Until the rapture and the church is gone, you can still be saved. Amen. The blood of Jesus is still powerful and good, wonderful. Amen. It's good to know about the blood of Jesus. Hey, and it doesn't matter how many churches quit singing about it or preaching about it. It's still real and right and good. And I'm thankful for it this morning. Hallelujah. Hey, hallelujah. Our daughters know about the blood of Jesus in their life. Our sons know about the blood of Jesus in their life. Amen. And sinners can know about the blood of Jesus for their life. That's good stuff right there. Amen, amen, amen. Yes, it ain't in this, so I'm not reading it yet. The blood of Jesus. It's good. Well, actually, it is right here in type in Genesis 22 as the ram is sacrificed at the end. God provided Himself a lamb in this story. You know why? Because there had to be bloodshed. I'm thankful there don't have to be any more. He died once for all. They'll never crucify Him again. Amen. He's not coming as the lamb anymore, but the lion. Hallelujah for that. And I'm on His side. Thank God. Hey, and even better than that, He's on my side. You say, well, that's awful arrogant. Well, no, it's just what the Bible says. It says He's for me. Amen. He's not ashamed to be called my God. Jesus is not ashamed to be called my brother. Amen. I got two brothers. Hey, listen, we was going through some troubles here years ago. My oldest brother said, do I need to come there? And he wasn't coming here to talk nice to nobody. I said, do not come. Do not come. You know what he is coming to do? He is coming to be a brother, man. Because he's for me. Now, he's hit me many times. He didn't want nobody else hitting on me. Amen. And Jesus is not ashamed to be called our brother. You know what that means? He's for me. And he's for you. If you're saved. That's good stuff. Boy, I'm feeling pretty good about the blood of Jesus right now. If you don't have it on your soul, you better get it. You better get born again and get the blood of Jesus applied to your soul today. Genesis 22, verse 1. And it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham and said unto him, Abraham, he said, behold, I am here. But behold, here I am. He said, take thee now thy son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I will tell thee of. Look at verse 9. They came to the place which God had told Abraham of, and Abraham built an altar there, and laid the wood in order, and bound Isaac his son, and laid him on the altar upon the wood. And Abraham stretched forth his hand and took the knife to slay his son. And the angel of the Lord called unto him out of heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, Here am I. And he said, Lay not thine hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him. Don't you know that was good news? Amen. For now I know that thou fearest God, seeing thou hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, from me. And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. That's a good picture of the crown of thorns right there, those, that thicket having that ram by the head. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered him up for a burnt offering in the stead of his son. Probably just one page over, Genesis 24. Genesis 24, that was about Abraham and Isaac. Now over here, Isaac has grown up. Genesis 24, verse 2. And Abraham said unto his eldest servant of his house that ruled over all that he had, Put, I pray thee, thy hand under my thigh, and I will make thee swear by the Lord, the God of heaven, the God of the earth, that thou shalt not take a wife unto my son of the daughters of the Canaanites among whom I dwell. And he begins to make him swear here to go to his country in verse 4 to find a bride for Isaac. Look at verse 63. Verse 63 of that chapter. And Isaac went out to meditate in the field at the eventide, and he lifted up his eyes and saw, and behold, the camels were coming. And Rebekah lifted up her eyes, and when she saw Isaac, she lighted off the camel, for she had said unto the servant, What man is this that walketh in the field to meet us? And the servant had said, It is my master. Therefore she took a veil and covered herself. And the servant told Isaac all things that he had done. And Isaac brought her into his mother Sarah's tent and took Rebekah, and she became his wife. And he loved her. And look at this. Isaac was comforted after his mother's death. Turn all the way over to Joshua. You're in Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua chapter 5. Joshua chapter 5. We're going to read this and one other scripture, and then we'll get rolling. I see it's already 14 minutes till the hour, so stay with me. Joshua chapter 5, verse 13. Verse 13 of Joshua chapter 5. Listen to it. And it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho. Most of you know Jericho is that great big walled city that the children of Israel had to fight. The very first battle in the promised land. Said he was by Jericho that he lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, there stood a man over against him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went unto him and said unto him, Art thou for us? I like it. Or for our adversaries? And he said, Nay, but as captain of the host of the Lord am I now come. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and did worship, and said unto him, What saith my Lord unto his servant? And the captain of the Lord's host said unto Joshua, Loose thy shoe from off thy foot, for the place whereon thou standest is holy. And Joshua did so. Last place, all the way over in John chapter 6, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, New Testament. John chapter 6. Don't normally read this many before the actual introduction, but I wanted to this morning. John chapter 6. Verse 3, are you still awake? Say amen. Genesis 22 was Abraham about to take the life of his son Isaac. Genesis 24 is Abraham telling the servant, Go get a bride for my son. At the end of the chapter, Isaac gets his bride. He and Rebekah meet, and God blesses them there. In Joshua chapter 5, the children of Israel facing Jericho, that great battle, and the captain of the host shows up for them. John chapter 6, verse 3, Jesus went up into a mountain, and there he sat with his disciples. And the Passover feast of the Jews was nigh, and when Jesus lifted up his eyes, saw a great company come unto him, he saith unto Philip, Whence shall we buy bread that these may eat? Let's pray. Father, we do thank you, Lord, for the good spirit this morning, for the choir singing, the special singing. I'm thankful for the blessed truth of the doctrine of the blood of Jesus. Amen for that. Stir my heart, Lord, that even though we do fail and we make mistakes in all areas of our lives, I'm thankful we can get up and we can repent and we can go on, and you'll help us to do better. And I praise you for that. And I ask you now, Lord, that you'd help me to preach with power and be a blessing to somebody and an encouragement and a help. And we'll praise you for it. Lord, help me not to be distracted in my heart, my mind right now. I pray that you'd help me with that. And we'll praise you for that in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, all right, I don't know if you saw it, but there is a commonality in these stories. In all four of them, and it's not really that vague. You just might not have noticed. It's very clear there's something in common in all four of these stories in the verses. Here it is. In each situation, in Genesis 22 with Abraham, and Genesis 24 with Isaac and Rebekah, and Joshua 5 with Joshua, and then John chapter 6 with Jesus himself, in each situation, the Bible said, they lifted up their eyes, in every one of them. They lifted up their eyes. Now, in each of those situations, just like in the lives of many Christians today, disappointment, heartache, stress, fatigue, things like that had come into their lives, and it had caused each of those people to be in a situation where they were walking around with their head down. They were walking around with their eyes down, their head down. The Bible talks about it in Psalms, verse 42, chapter 42, verse 6. He said, "Oh my God, my soul is cast down within me." See, there seems to be an epidemic of discouragement and depression in the world and also in the church. And because of that, just like in each of these situations, we are oftentimes walking around with our head down. Often we are walking around with our soul cast down, the psalmist said. We're walking around with our eyes toward the ground. Now, I began to read these stories and think about them, and I started noticing what good things they saw when they looked up. They lifted up their eyes, each one of them. They lifted up their eyes, and when they did, they saw some very good things. Now, in Luke 21, the apostles were talking to Jesus, and they said, "Lord, tell us about the last days, and tell us what are going to be the signs of those last days." And he begins to describe to them some of the things that will be going on in the last days. He says things like wars and commotions. He said things like fearful sights, nations rising against nation. He said great earthquakes in diverse places, famines, pestilences. He mentioned that the Christians would be persecuted. Is any of this sounding familiar to you? It's all going on right now. He mentioned divisions among friends and family. He mentioned Jerusalem compassed about with armies. In other words, that the Jews would be surrounded by people that hate them, and they are surrounded by people that hate them. And us arming Iran and giving them all that money in the last week or so. And if you think for a minute they're not trying to make a bomb that'll blow up Israel and make one that'll blow us up, then you're just fooling yourself, friends. They are evil men, and they are bound by a hatred for the Jew and for the nation of America, because we've always stood with the Jew, not so much lately, but in the past. And so the Lord's given them these signs, and he said there'll be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars, and upon the earth, distress of nations. He said the sea and the waves roaring. And boy, we see that more, it seems like, than ever before. And so Jesus is talking to these apostles. Now, you got to understand that the apostles never really understood that Jesus was going to die and that he was going to leave. They just never, even though he told them, they just never really could believe it. They always thought that he was going to go ahead and set up his kingdom and that they would go ahead right then and rule and reign with him. So I believe when they asked him about the last days, they were looking for good news. I believe they were looking for him to say how things were real bad right then, but they were going to get better and better and better and better, and then he would sit on the throne and they would be wonderful. But instead he starts saying wars and commotions and famine and pestilence, and he said they're going to persecute you, they're going to lock you up, and it's going to be bad. And in the midst of that, their heads begin to drop. You say, how do you know? Because at the end of all of it, here's what Jesus said. Now this is very important, because we're seeing these things come to pass right now. Jesus said, when you see these things begin to come to pass, then look up, lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. That's what he said. By the way, he said it to the apostles, but he recorded it so that we might read it, because we're the ones living when all these things are beginning to come to pass. And so what I'm trying to tell you is there are some people, including the Lord himself here, who are walking around in their life and they are cast down in their spirit. They've looked around and some things have happened and some stuff has come and it's caused them to be cast down in their spirit. And the Lord knew that was going to happen. And here's what he said. In the last days, if you're not careful, you're going to live like that. You're going to walk around cast down. You're going to walk around defeated and depressed and discouraged. But what I want you to see from these stories is I began to wonder about this. I wonder what I might miss with my head down. I wonder what I might miss that God's doing if my head's down all the time. And so let me remind you very quickly about these four stories and show you what they saw when they lifted up their eyes. First of all, you don't have to turn, but back in Genesis 22, Abraham saw God's miraculous provision. That's what he saw when he lifted up his eyes. See, Abraham's head was down, I believe, because of disappointment. Abraham had prayed and asked God for a son, and God had said, you'll have one. And many of you know the story. He had waited years and years and years, and finally he's 100 years old, and God did a miracle in their body, and Isaac was finally born, and now he's growing up, and Abraham's watching the promises of God unfold before his very eyes. And then God comes and says a strange thing. He says, I want you to take that boy that you love, your only son, and take him up on the mountain, and I want you to take his life, sacrifice him. Now, Abraham in the story was willing to obey. He was obeying God. But I believe in his heart he was thinking, I didn't think this is going to happen. I don't understand why this is happening. Why would God ask for the life of my only son, the very son that he promised to give me, the very son that he did give me? And I believe that disappointment has caused Abraham to lower his head. And even though he's being obedient with a cast down spirit. As a matter of fact, if you read in verse 4, here's what you'll find out. They start the journey toward that mountain that was a good way off, and the Bible said that he lifted up his eyes and saw the place where they were going. I mean, so as soon as that morning, he knew what he's getting ready to have to do. He's like, come on, son. Come on, servants. Get the wood and get this and get that. And they started heading out. Abraham's heading out like this. Lord, I don't understand this. Lord, this is not how I thought it was going to go. And disappointment has caused him to lower his eyes, to be cast down in spirit. But he gets up there on the mountain, and the angel shows up and encourages him. And here's what happens. When he lifts up his head, he sees that ram caught in the thickets. He sees that God has miraculously provided what he needed in this situation. Listen, I'd hate to get to heaven and find out that God had miraculous provisions right out in front of me, but that I was too cast down to see it. If you're down, listen, if you're down today because of disappointment in something that's happened in your life that you thought, I didn't believe it was going to go this way, disappointment in some person that has let you down, whatever it is that's got you cast down in spirit, if you're down because of disappointment, why don't you ask God to lift up your head today? Amen. Why don't you say, Lord, I want you to help me somehow in my spirit to be able to lift up my head, because maybe what I need is right out in front of me, and I might miss it if my head's down. Are you still with me? Say amen. In Genesis 24, Isaac and Rebekah both have their head down. And they saw, when they lifted their head, God's wondrous plan. Abraham saw God's miraculous provision. He never would have saw the ram if he hadn't lifted up his eyes. But the angel encouraged him, and he lifted up his eyes, and there God had miraculously met his need and gave him the desire of his heart. And now Isaac and Rebekah, Isaac is grown, and Isaac is down. I believe their heads are down because of sorrow and loneliness. You say, why would you say that? Because in the previous chapter, Isaac's mama has died. Some of you have lost your mom. And even as an adult, I can't imagine what that must feel like. It's a heartbreaking. It's a time of great grief and sorrow. He's lost his mom. At the end of the story, when he finally gets this wife, the Bible says that after he loved her, he was comforted after his mother's death. And so we know Isaac was struggling with the loss of his mother. He's sitting out there by himself. I believe his head is cast down, his heart is cast down out of sorrow and loneliness. And then Rebecca's coming. And Rebecca has now left her family, and she's left them for a man she's never met, because she believes it's what God wants her to do. But she's traveling a long journey, not really knowing how it's going to go. All she's got is this servant as a companion. And by the end of the journey, you know what you find out? She's cast down. I believe the same reason. I believe there's a little bit of sorrow in her heart that she's had to leave home. I believe there's a little bit of loneliness in her heart that she don't have her sister. She don't have her brother. She don't have her mom or dad. She's with this stranger making this long journey, going to somebody that she's never met before. And so she's cast down, and Isaac is cast down by sorrow, by loneliness. But the Bible says when they lifted up their eyes, they saw God's wondrous plan for each one of them standing right there. Hey, he saw the wife that God had provided for him. She saw the husband that God had as the plan for her life. I mean, right in front of them, listen now, was the thing that God would use to fill that void of loneliness in each of their lives. She's lost her family, but there's the one that's going to fill the void. He's lost his mom, and there's the one that's going to fill the void. Hey, that sorrow, that thing that's going to help alleviate the sorrow from the circumstances of their life, was right in front of them when they lifted up their eyes. They looked up and saw God's wondrous plan. Hey, I don't want to walk around in this life sorrowful any longer than I have to. See, we know that everybody's going to get a certain amount of sorrow. Everybody's going to go through loss. Everybody's going to have a certain amount of loneliness in their life at some time. But I don't want to go through it any longer than I have to. I don't want to add time to my sorrow and loneliness because the answer was out in front of me, but I was too cast down to see it. I believe there are people that miss the plan of God that would help them with their sorrow, that would help them with their loneliness, that would help them with the longing in their heart. But they are so cast down by the devil, by discouragement, by circumstances, that they can't even see that God has a wondrous plan for their life out in front of them. I don't want to go through it any longer than I have to. I want to make sure that every now and then that the Spirit of God, the help of God, hey, listen, just like a song this morning, hey, the doctrine of the blood of Jesus, you know what it did for me this morning? It lifted me up a little bit this morning. I start thinking about I fail, I fall, and I don't like that. And you start getting beat down and cast down, and guilt bears you down. Hey, but then every now and then the Holy Ghost can come and begin to stir in that heart. Hey, and He can lift up your head, and then He can show you sometimes, hey, I got what you need, like I had for Abraham, and I've got the plan for your life right out here in front of you. I don't want to miss it because I'm so cast down. They miss some things because their head was down. If you're down because you're dealing with sorrow and loneliness, ask God to lift up your head today. There in Joshua chapter 5, Abraham saw God's miraculous provision. Isaac and Rebekah saw God's wondrous plan. Joshua in Joshua chapter 5, he saw God's glorious presence. In that story, Joshua was there outside of Jericho. I believe Joshua's head was down because of stress and worry. Anybody got any stress in your life? Isn't that the dumbest question anybody's ever asked you? I always think, doctors, don't ask us that. Every one of us is going to say yes, because we all got some. Are there any worriers in here? You know what stress and worry will do to you? Cast you down. You'll stress and you'll worry yourself to the point that you can't get up. Hey, listen, it happens on the platform, man. You're sitting here on the platform, you look around and you see things, you know, oh, and then my mind kicks right in and I start saying, oh, boy, I wonder about this, and well, maybe I need to do that, and boy, I'm going to have to, boy, I hope that ain't what's going on. Lord, don't let that be. Now, I'm sitting right here, I'm supposed to come preach in just a minute, and I'm getting cast down from worry and stress sitting right there on the platform. I know what happens to you. It's happening to Joshua right here. He's the leader. They're facing their first battle under his leadership. And when he gets there to it, it's the great walled city of Jericho, the unbeatable foe. How would you like that? I mean, Moses has been their leader. I mean, everything Moses touched turned to gold spiritually. God just helped him. And now you're the leader, and God's told you, and He's told the people, but they're all watching to see how this is going to go. And your first battle, you know, you would think if you was him, Lord, couldn't you give me something little to start with so we can get a good victory under our belt, right? And God says, no, how about Jericho? And I believe He's walking around wringing His hands saying, Lord, because listen, in Joshua chapter 5 where we read, He don't, look at me. See, most of y'all know the story. You know that God said, march around it once a day, 6 days, seventh day, march 7 times, blow your trumpets and shout, and I'm going to knock the walls down. See, we know that story. Raise your hand if you know that story. You got to know something. Where we read right there, Joshua don't know that yet. He has not yet received the story. He's not received the instruction. He's not had God say, this is what I'm going to do. He's looking at it now just as a general. And you know what he's thinking? We can't do that. And so he's walking around like this. Man, Lord, how are we going to do this? Man, Lord, how are we going to do this? Lord, what, I know you told us to come here and you told us just to give us a victory, but Lord, I don't have any idea. And he's walking around, but I tell you this, praise the Lord, somewhere along the way, he lifted up his head. From that stress of where he lifted up his head. And you know what he saw? He saw that angel of the Lord, it said. He saw that captain of the host standing there with his sword drawn. Now let me tell you what he really saw. He saw Jesus. That's an Old Testament appearance of Jesus. Just like Jesus showed up in the fiery furnace with the three Hebrew children, Jesus showed up. You say, how do you know that? There's three things that show us. One, he's called the captain of the host, and in Hebrews, Jesus is called the captain of our salvation. That's one good way. The second way is this, that when he starts talking to him, he says this. He said, hey, wait just a minute. You're standing on holy ground. Take your shoes off. Now, we'd already seen that once before, and it's when Moses was talking to God in the burning bush. The third thing is, when he says that to him, he falls down and worships, and this being lets him worship him. In Revelation 22, John the Revelator speaks to an angel, and he falls down before that angel and starts to worship. And the angel says, you get up, I'm a creature like you, you don't worship me. This guy here lets him worship. You know why? Because he's worthy of it. Because it's Jesus. So here he is walking around in stress and worry, and he's got himself cast down. But he lifts up his eyes, and what he sees is God's presence in the middle of his battle. Don't you know things started feeling better? He walked up now. He didn't recognize it at first. He just saw the sword. He just saw the might, no doubt. And he walks up, and he said, "Are you for us or against us?" He said, "I'm for you. I'm the captain of the host here to help you." And after that, he gives him the instructions for how they're going to win. And so he shows up, and he's got the plan. And the Lord shows up, and he's got the power. And the Lord shows up and says, "I'm going to participate. I'm here to help you with what you're going through. I'm telling you, you got to lift up your head sometime, because Jesus will show up in your life." Amen. Oh, but I'm afraid. I'm afraid there have been times I'm so cast down that he shows up and I don't see him. And I leave just as cast down, or maybe even more, because I thought he was going to show up and then he didn't. And the Lord's saying, "I did." Some of you have heard the old illustration, sort of a joke. I don't really know if it's a joke or an illustration. Either way, you've heard about that flood coming to that city. And they started going to houses and rescuing. They came to this guy's house. He's sitting on a porch. They had a little boat. And they said, "Hey, we're here to help you. We're here to get people to higher ground." And he said, "No, I've prayed about it. God's going to save me." So they left him alone. Come around about a day later, the water has risen. He's up in a second story window, and they say, "Hey," they got a little bit bigger boat. They say, "We're here to help people. Come on, get in the boat. We're going to take you to higher ground." He said, No, I don't need your help. I've prayed and God's going to save me." They come around a third time with a helicopter. He's up on the roof of his house. They say the same thing. He says the same thing. "I don't need your help. God's going to help me." And then he dies. And he goes to heaven and he says, "God, I don't understand. I don't understand how you failed me. I thought you was going to save me." And God says, "I sent you two boats and a helicopter. You didn't." You know what it was? He didn't see it. So cast down, stress and worry, God shows up. Hey, God comes in these services. Despite our faults and failures, despite my faults and failures, he shows. People ask me all the time when I travel, they say, "How's it going?" I'll say, "Man, it's going good despite who's in charge." I say that all the time. I said, "They got a crazy guy in charge, and God still blesses." And listen, he shows up here. The Lord Jesus comes in these services, but I'm afraid many times the Christian is so cast down by the stress and worry of that great walled city that stands before you, that unbeatable foe, that you're so cast down you can't even lift your head up enough to see that Jesus is standing there with his sword drawn saying, "I'm here for you." And you leave cast down. Some things we miss when our head's down. Brother David, you go ahead and come and get ready. That last one was in John chapter 6. Jesus himself. Hey, if you're down because you're dealing with stress and worry, ask God to lift up your head today. But in John 6, Jesus is down. You say, whoa, why in the world would Jesus be down? Well, the Bible said there in John 6, you're probably still looking at that one, verse 5, when Jesus then lifted up his eyes. You say, why do you think Jesus was down? Because he was tired. Physically, in his human flesh, I believe he was tired. See, he had been dealing with the needs of the multitudes, and he had gone up into a mountain with his disciples to try and sort of get away. In Luke chapter 9, verse 10, telling this same story, it says this, said he took them and went aside privately in a desert place. And so he was healing and helping, and there was this multitude. And by the way, he was 100% man and somehow 100% God, but we know that he would get hungry like a man gets hungry, and he would get tired like a man gets tired. And he knew his apostles would get tired. And so he'd worked all day with this great multitude. So finally he says, "Hey guys, let's just take a break. Come with me up here to the mountain. Let's just get away for a minute." In one place it said this, he took them privately to that desert place. But in Mark it said, this happens when the day was far spent. So it's been a long day. Have you ever had a long day? Have you ever had a bunch of them strung together? You get tired. You know what's natural when you get tired? Just have your head down. You're just tired. I believe Jesus is just tired. Physically wore out from going and going and going. He's got his head down. But the Bible said when Jesus lifted up his eyes, you say, what did he see? Well, he didn't need miraculous provision. He's the Lord. That's what Abraham saw. Hey, he didn't need, the wondrous plan that Isaac and Rebecca, he didn't need to see the will of God. He knew the will of God. He didn't need the glorious presence of Jesus because he is Jesus. You know what he saw? When he lifted his eyes, he saw God's zealous passion. He saw the Father's passion when he lifted up his eyes. You say, what do you mean? The Bible said when Jesus lifted up his eyes, he saw the multitude. And the Bible said in Matthew 14:14, he was moved with compassion toward them. You know what is the passion of God? People in need. Jesus was tired. Thinking about, you know, I just got to rest a bit. And when he lifted up his eyes, he saw a multitude in need. And even though he is tired, it grabbed him. He goes, oh, that's what it's all about. That's what's on my Father's heart. And so immediately he goes to work. He starts talking to the apostles. And he starts working out how he's going to meet their need. You know what I'm afraid of, Brother Justin? I'm afraid sometimes God will bring the very passion of his heart in front of me. People in need. And he wants me to help them. But I'm afraid sometime I got my head so down, I can't even see them. Or I got my heart so down, I can't even see their need because I'm so focused on my own. It would have been easy for Jesus to say, man, I'm just wore out. I can't deal with that multitude right now. But he knew it was the heart of God. And so even tired, he says, fellas, what do we got? We gotta do something. One says, I got this little lunch, and they begin to work again and meet the needs of others. I don't want to miss the people God brings in my path that need help because I'm walking around with my head down. I wonder today, have you been cast down? Are you dealing with disappointment like Abraham was? Things just ain't turning out the way you thought they would. And you're just down. Why don't you say, God, would you stir my heart up again today? Because I don't want to miss it if you've got a miraculous provision out in front of me. Have you been dealing with loneliness, sorrow, just a loss, something in your life, and it's got you down? Why don't you say, God, stir my heart up again today. I don't want to miss your will for my life. I don't want to miss the plan you've got for how you're going to fix my sorrow. How you going to fix my loneliness because my head's down? Hey, are you dealing with, you know, what Joshua was dealing with, just stress and worry about some big thing in your life? Why don't you say, Lord, help me to have my heart stirred up today that I don't miss your presence when you're trying to give me instruction and strength? I wonder if you're just tired, just wore out. But you would say, Lord, help me not miss the people you bring in my life that I can help. Because that's what's on your heart. Would you stand with me? Have you been dealing with disappointment, sorrow, loneliness, stress, worry, fatigue? Let's ask God to lift our heads today so we might see the help. Everybody look here. Don't bow your heads just yet. The Bible said in Psalms, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills from which cometh my, does anybody know? Help. My help cometh from the Lord. Look here. I wonder if we miss his help because we're so cast down. I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills from which cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord. I wonder if you're cast down. Now you can bow your heads. I wonder if anybody would say, preacher, pray for me. I've been cast down. You don't have to tell us which one it is. It may be disappointment. It may be sorrow. It may be loneliness. It may be you're just tired. It may be disappointment. Whatever it may be, would you just say, preacher, I've been cast down. I've had a hard time in my spirit. Would you raise your hand if you've been cast down? Lift it up high.